I think we need a reminder about the importance of the First Amendment. Speech, press, peaceful assembly, petition, and religion. These are the freedoms not given to us by our government, but that we have naturally and need to be protected from government restriction. The way the Constitution, the Bill of Rights is written, is not that the government gives us these rights, it's that they can't take them away. It's like for a teenager, if your parents say you can go to the movies on Saturday night, that might not lead to a different result than your parents saying we can't stop you from going to the movies on Saturday night. But one of those situations, the power is in your parents. Your parents giving you the power to go to the movies, then they could take it away. But if their hands are tied and they say we can't stop you from going to the movies on Saturday night, yes, it looks the same. You're going to the movies one way or the other. But one of them, the way it is written, matters. And one of them limits the power of your parents. Well, that's the way the Constitution is written. It's not that our government gives us these rights. It's that they cannot take them away. Now, right now, and for the past many years, the Supreme Court and the decisions to get new justices on the Supreme Court has really been focused on one issue, and that is Roe v. Wade, the abortion issue. But in many ways, this is a manufactured place of contention. Data shows that the vast majority of Americans actually support abortion rights in the first 3 months or first trimester. And even if Roe v. Wade would get overturned, very little would actually change. In liberal states like California or New York, nothing would change because Roe v. Wade getting overturned would just default back to states' rights to determine the legalities of abortion. And technically, because abortion isn't mentioned in the Constitution, it actually should be a states' rights issue, but that's a whole different thing. The states that would be affected, like a lot of the states in the South, also wouldn't be affected that much. There's 5 states in the United States of America that only have 1 abortion clinic. And even those, you have to get parent signatures. There's all kinds of new regulations and stuff like that. Because what the decision for Roe v. Wade was, is through the rights of privacy covered under the 9th Amendment, you cannot shut down or make illegal abortion in the first trimester. You can make it really hard, and many states do. But yet, all the discussion about the Supreme Court seems to be revolving around this one issue, where I think the bigger issue that we should be looking to the Supreme Court for is the First Amendment. Right now, we have corporations that are too big to fail. And these corporations, in many ways, are more powerful than the United States government. And Twitter and Yelp and YouTube, and then eventually banks and things like that, are wielding massive power and shutting down your First Amendment. Now, they're allowed to because they're private organizations, but that doesn't mean that it's good. Part of the First Amendment is also the right to bring civil lawsuits. And America is very litigious, which is a double-edged sword. There's good things about being able to sue, which is penalizing bad actors, but there's also negatives. It's very hard to get a straight answer from a lot of doctors and corporations and things like that because they're so scared of being sued. So what we need to do is we need to get cases into the courts. And once cases are into the courts about shutting down speech, it'll eventually work its way up to the Supreme Court. And we need a Supreme Court that's going to uphold the First Amendment. It is very, very important that we have our freedom to express ourselves. But on a more personal level, how about we shift from a call-out culture? You're a bad actor, you have bad ideas, all that kind of stuff, cancel culture, all of that. How about instead of a call out culture, we have a call in culture? A culture where we say, you disagree with me, come on in, let's have a discussion. Let's make long form, nuanced conversations great again. Mufunga, no, that's not a good acronym. But conversations and debate used to be hours and hours and hours. The Lincoln-Douglas debates were like, 3 hours of Lincoln talking, 3 hours of Douglas talking, then people would get an hour or two break, then 3 more hours and 3 more hours. They would go days of talking. But now it's just quick sound bites. The debates, you have 20 seconds to talk. Tell me your platform for what you would do as president. You have 1 minute. It's not good. We need to have people speak more. We need to make long form conversations something that we embrace in this country. Look, aren't you interested in what people actually think? You should be. You shouldn't want a highly edited, out of context soundbite. You should want to know, what does this person think? And that takes time. That takes interaction. That takes nuance. And Joe Rogan, the human thumb, and I love you, Joe, showed that there is a market for this when Spotify paid him nine figures for his long-form podcast. People are interested in sitting down and listening for hours and hours and hours to understand what people think. Now, he's a stand-up comedian. He's really good at keeping the conversation going. But at the end of the day, there is a market for long-form conversation, and we need to embrace that. Look, it's in our DNA. It's how we evolved, sitting around the fire, eating woolly mammoth, and talking about life, and how do we do this better, and how do we do that better? Let's have more conversations. And part of what I'm trying to do with my social media, my Patreon, where you can support me there, Heterodox Academy, and elsewhere, is try to promote civil discourse and truly looking to understand why people think what they think and work towards something better. It's in our Constitution for a reason. We need to protect it, and we need to embrace it.